As usual, the castaway is introduced by Roy Plumley.
Our castaway this week is a comedian, writer, musician, actor, painter, and character, and there aren't many of those around these days.
Mother and housewife. Yes.
It's Spike Milligan. How much time do you spend listening to music?
All day.
Really?
Yes. This is where BBC comes good. Radio 3 is about the... Without it, I don't think England would know there any classical music.
How did you set about choosing your 8 records? Are you choosing nostalgically or great music or what?
Well, it's such a vast spectrum of music, it's ridiculous. You know, I just run my fingers down the index and said, give them 8 of those. And we just picked 8 out very quickly off the cuff. I didn't take in a great time out of them. So much good music, you can't go wrong. You
know. What's the first one?
The first one is Festi Romana by Respighi, a very much neglected composer. But I think this was a wonderful piece of arranging and composing here.
The opening of Respighi's Festi Romani, Arturo Toscanini and the NBC Symphony Orchestra. Spike, it's a well-known historical fact that you were born in India. Your Indian roots were...
Historical, is it?
Well,
it was contemporary, never mind.
Your Indian roots went back several generations.
Did they?
Well, you tell me.
Yes, they went back to about... I know that a grandfather Kettleman was at the Delhi Gate when they blew it in.
When was that? The
1850s? 1850, yes, about 1850, I think. The mutiny was about 1851, wasn't it? 52, like that.
And your first school was in a tent?
Yes, a military a sergeant in a tent, in the Hyderabad Sin desert it was. Mm-hmm. We had to sit on the tent pegs when the wind blew up. We each had a tent peg to sit on to hold it down.
How old were you when you came to England?
About 14.
Did it look like home, or did it look cold and grey?
It looked cold and grey and awful and terrible, and it still does. You get used to it, just like if you've always had bare feet, even a terrible pair of boots, you can get used to in the end.
Have you been back to India?
I find it overwhelming nostalgia. It would destroy me, because everything is gone that I used to know and love.
Now, you were here at 14. What did you want to be as a schoolboy? Did you want to keep up the army tradition? What did you
want? I wanted to be a fighter pilot.
Mm.
And we came to England for that reason in mind, and I sat for the exam at Kingsway, and I failed because I was hopeless at mathematics. But strangely enough, when the war came on and they were getting shot down left, right and centre, I suddenly received a communique from the RAF saying, we are rethinking about you joining the Air Force, and we think you'd make a splendid rear gunner.
Yes,
and
I
wrote back
gunner.
And said, no, I don't want to be a rear gunner. I want to see what's coming at the front, you know.
Hmm. What was your first job? What did you do?
I worked at Stones Engineering Work, Getford, for 13 shillings a week. Getting my hands trapped in a Miller 6 machine, making little round plugs for some water pumps.
You were also playing trumpet in a dance band.
Yeah. That's and, good terse answer, isn't it? Yeah.
Yes.
That's
yes.
The end of it.
Well, then you got swept up in the war before you'd really started anything. Gunner Milligan of the Royal Artillery
yes.
at Bexhill Girls' School.
That's right, yes.
Mm-hmm.
But we unfortunately got there just after they'd left.
Yeah.
It's never the same.
Well, you had a rather pointless barrack room life for about 3 years before anything much happened, but it did improve your trumpet playing, didn't it?
Yeah, we played great jazz in those days. Well, it was swing. It was really called swing. Mm. It was the era of Bunny Berrigan, and Harry James was the sort of the last of the swing trumpet players who survived.
And you won a contest?
Believe it or not, yes. Harry Parry had the Radio Rhythm Club.
Yes.
And he advertised for musicians who'd like to sit and come up to London, Maydevale Studios, and have a contest. So I won the trumpet thing, and the chap on the piano was George Shearing.
Yes.
And we cut a disc there at Maydevale Studios, and I often wonder what happened to it, you know.
It was broadcast, wasn't it?
I don't know.
Radio Rhythm Club or something?
The Radio Rhythm Club used to broadcast. I don't know if they broadcast this particular disc. I don't know.
Well, if anybody's got that disc, you'd like to hear about
it. I would like to hear about it, yes. Hmm. Yeah.
In the meantime, your second record.
My second record. Jesse Owens doing the 100 yards at Burn. my second one is A Woman of Ireland by the Chieftains. So I think it was composed especially for the film Barry Lyndon.
Women of Ireland. Why did you choose that in particular, Spike?
Well, I have latent Celtic roots. They seem hanging out sometimes. I just felt it was terribly Irish, and I was delighted to think that somebody could write such an Irish tune as that in the 20th century.
Sean O'Riordan.
Good luck, Sean. God bless. God bless all here, sir.
Right.
This Irish woman got into bed with her husband and said, I've set the alarm clock for 6. He said, why? There's only 2 of us.
It's getting worse. Terence Allen Patrick, who started calling you Spike?
In the Gunners, in the army.
It's a traditional name for Milligan,
I presume so. I don't know. It's completely mine. There's another guy called Spike Deans in the regiment as well.
In those days in Bexhill, with nothing much to do, you and your mates began to evolve a new and rather desperate type of humour.
Yes, it was. I think the siege of this Goonia was starting to implement itself then, yes.
Where did the word goon come from?
From the Popeye cartoon at the time. Popeye had these long creatures called goons who had no faces, just 2 eyes, and they had talks bubbles with rubbish inside, didn't they?
Well, then, 1943, North Africa, life got real and earnest and very dangerous. You were wounded.
I wasn't wounded in North Africa, no.
You were blown up, weren't you?
What, you mean like a balloon or what?
No,
I was blown up in Italy.
You were blown up in Italy?
Yes,
that
yes.
That was after North Africa.
Yes. Yeah. Well, I came down again.
Yes.
Had to, you know.
Yes, just as well. Apart from getting better, what were you planning to do after the war?
Oh, teaching a chap the law of gravity at school, and he couldn't get it, they said. He said, well, I'll tell you what the law of gravity is. He said, stand over there and jump up and down. So the chap jumped up and down. He said, now, did you see what happened? And he said, you jumped up in there, but you had to come down to earth again. Now, why? He said, well, because I lived there.
You can't fault it, can you?
No, no. What were you going to say, Roy? I'm sorry.
I said, apart from getting better, what were you planning to do after the war?
Nothing at all. I took it by the day. I think I had a feeling I wanted to be a leader of a big swinging band, a trumpet, and wear a white jacket and have a red carnation.
Yeah. You travelled around Europe for a bit with a band?
Yes, we formed a hot Club de France sort of trio, and we did comedy on the stage, and we were a big hit with the troops at the end of the war, and after the war we toured with an Italian company, the Rivista company, and Ugo Tognazzi, the contemporary Italian actor, he was the comic on the show, yes.
Mm-hmm.
And bit by bit I drifted into writing.
Yes.
God knows how.
What did you write for a start?
Czechs. well, I wrote bits and pieces for Peter Sellers and Alfred Marx and Harry Secombe.
Yes. You were never particular about the company you kept. There was that little drinking club just opposite the Windmill Theatre, full of comedians.
Yeah, Papa, I didn't drink, though, at the thing. I used to go up there because I fancied the bird behind the bar. I never had any money, and she used to lend it to me.
Yes. Well, that was where the Goon Show was born, really, in that room, wasn't it?
Not really. It was anywhere. I don't know where it was born, really.
How did it start? It can't have been easier to have sold that anarchic form of humour to the BBC. How did it happen?
Well, it's a very fine man, not many people all know, called Pat Dixon, who was a bit of an avant-garde revolutionary. He had the Dixie rebel flag behind his desk, and he got it through the back door.
And he fought for it?
Yes, he did. He put it on against all the wishes of everybody, I think.
Mm-hmm. Let's have another record. What's number three?
Number three now. Debussy is one of my favourite composers. Because he's a miniaturist, like does things in small little packets. And I like his En Bateau, which I believe he wrote for his daughter.
Debussy's En Bateau, John Ogden and Brenda Lucas. How many programmes were there of the Goon Show altogether?
Oh, I don't know. It must have been over 150, I think.
You must have pretty well written yourself out on that. It was a terrific chore.
Well, that's why I stopped. I thought, we can't go on like this.
Mm-hmm. You'd done all the work, but Peter and Harry soared up to international stardom, leaving you a bit behind. Did that worry you at the time?
Yes, it did. When it all finished, I was sort of an unemployed scriptwriter. And Peter, of course, had done well in the film world, and Harry had done well on the stage. And I had no confidence at all. I still have very lack of confidence. And I thought, I've got to do something. So I thought, I think I'm a good clown. I thought, I must be a good clown, and I'm going to push myself. So we did this play called Oblomov, which was terrible. So I ad-libbed the whole thing, and it became a great hit in London.
Well, you've diversified and made a success of all those jobs I listed at the beginning.
I'm a clown, really, though. I think I'm a jobbing clown. That's what I am.
Another record.
John Lennon, I find, one of the most beguiling commercial singers. He doesn't try anything awkward. His voice haunting, and it's at its best, singing McCartney's composition, Yesterday.
Yesterday?
Yes. Yesterday, someone came and took the cat away.
All right, don't go and wreck it. It's a good song.
It's just beautiful.
You wrote Oblomov, opened up a new career for yourself as an actor.
Actor. It's funny that nobody ever asked me to appear in pantomime or to come and act on the stage. Nothing at all. I've always wanted to be in a pantomime. I'm a good clown. Mm. I love children.
You've been in Treasure Island?
Yes, that was not a pantomime exactly. It was a play.
Yes. Right. Yes. And you've written other plays yourself?
No, I wrote Bed Sitting Room myself.
Bed Sitting Room, right. That's the one I was thinking.
With John Antrobus, yes.
Mm-hmm. And your books, all sorts of books. Your splendid 3-volume war autobiography, Adolf Hitler, My Part in His Downfall.
Crash.
Rommel,
yeah.
Gunner Who?
Gunner Who?
And Monty, His Part in My Victory.
It's all going to be all right, Milligan.
Are you going to write a trilogy about your
four-volume trilogy? I haven't finished it. I've just written the fourth volume.
Of the wartime?
Yeah, it's called Goodbye Soldier.
Splendid. When's that coming up?
I don't know. I've just finished handling the manuscript and to be typed.
And then there have been novels. Pakun was the first, was it?
Yes. And the last.
Really? Haven't you done another novel?
No, I haven't. I just started one the other day called The King.
Yes.
Yeah.
And books of verse, children's books, animal books.
Yeah.
And you've had a one-man exhibition of your paintings. I remember the first painting of yours I ever saw. It was at an exhibition at the Leicester Square Cinema in the foyer. And this one was called Painting Done with Knife and Fork. I thought it was very, very good indeed.
It was done with a knife and fork. I want to see if you could paint with a knife and fork. So I dipped it in and
did you sell it?
No, I couldn't sell it.
And, of course, you pop up in a television show occasionally.
Yes.
How long do they take you to do, to write?
Well, I write in conjunction with Neil Shand. When he turns up, we write together.
Mm-hmm.
And it takes a couple of months to knock it off, you know. What we try to do is to write original ideas, to infuse new ideas to television, you know.
Yes.
Well, it's easy to write sort of stand-up comic joke ones, you know, just straightforward sketches. We try to put on ideas like, for instance, two chaps walk in and say, this looks like a good place for a sketch, and they knock on an invisible door, and a chap comes up, and these chaps at the door have got stocking masks over their faces, and they're wearing clerical clothes, vicar's collars, and the chap says, who are you? And he says, we're Jehovah burglars. This is we're being persecuted for our beliefs. He said, what do you believe? Said, we believe you've got a lot of money in here. that's mad things like that.
Yeah. Do you act the stuff out when you write it?
Yes, but it always seems to get mutilated to the process of going through a large organization. We don't get enough time, and I want everyone to know this, to do these shows that we do. They're too complicated. We actually often go to air without actually having run through the whole show in costume and with the props. We've actually run out of time. And I don't think that they're going to make any progress in comedy on a visual level. I'm talking about visual comedy, making visual pictures, original pictures, unless they give more time to a show.
Another record.
Another record. Yes, Shostakovich's Sixth Symphony, Last Movement. Thank you.
The opening of the last movement of the Shostakovich Sixth Symphony, played by the Leningrad Symphony Orchestra. Why did you choose that?
Well, it's amazing, in an age of brutalism, to find a man who has all the seeds of the Romantic school of music, with a tremendous, almost the breadth of Mahler's feeling, all combined in one. I can still love his music, it's still romantic, and that last moment is very jolly, I found.
You talked about brutalism. You're a man with many causes. You've taken up cudgels against a lot of brutalism and idiocy. Which causes are most precious to you at this moment?
The one which I found one I'm most concerned about is world population.
Yes.
And that's the one which least work is being done on. I mean, the Earth is a lifeboat. There's enough room for so many people in a lifeboat.
Yes.
And nobody's piloting this lifeboat in any sensible form at the moment. They're just taking passengers on board all the time. It'll sink.
You're a conservationist above all.
Yes, I want to live a long time.
And you became a vegetarian because of that?
Yes, I did. I went and saw what was happening to these awful chicken broiler farms that I have for that and pigs, the way they put them in batteries. I was horrified. Yes.
There's one admirable gesture of yours. When some lurch defaced some wood carvings in Kensington Gardens, you spent months recarving them. Now some lurch have defaced them again. Is it worth going on? Are you going to do
it
again?
Well, I think the spirit of man must go on, yes. I think I broke my heart when I saw it being mutilated the week after we'd spent 3 years repairing it. But what was more heartbreaking is when I wrote to the minister and said, look, you can catch these louts. They come in after dark. You only need a policeman on duty at this point for 3 or 4 nights in the trot and you'll catch them. If not, put up higher railings. They ignored both. They eventually did put the railings up long after the tree had been mutilated to a degree which I thought was obscene.
Let's get back to music. What's number 6?
It's The Shadow of Your Smile, sung by who I think is the best down-the-line singer of our day, Frank Sinatra.
The shadow of your smile when you have gone will color all my dreams and light the dawn. Look into my eyes, my love, and see all the lovely things you are. Wistful little star, it was far too high. A teardrop kissed your lips, and so did I.
Sinatra. We've dumped him on this island, which isn't a bad island. It's got fresh water, it's got sunshine. How are you going to be at survival? Could you look after yourself?
Yeah, great.
You could build a hut?
Yeah, do the lot, man. Really, I'm a good survivor.
Would you try to escape?
No, I'd have tried to attract people's attention, I think.
Any ideas on that?
No, I've no idea. I don't think man can live entirely on his own forever, even though Alexander Selkirk did it to a great degree. I think eventually you'd get haunted by being on your own.
Mm.
I think you'd become impossible to live with, like all of us.
Record number 7.
Number 7? This is Grieg, one from his lyric suite, which I believe he wrote for his wife as a wedding present. I might be right or wrong. It's The Shepherd Boy.
Shepherd's Boy from Grieg's lyric suite. And Stanley Black was conducting the London Symphony Orchestra, and we've now come to your last disc.
Sounds like a spinal job, doesn't it? Your last disc. Ed Welsh, a friend of mine, was a wonderful composer, and he wrote a theme for a record we made. The theme is the Snow Goose theme, which I found delightful.
The Snow Goose theme from the recording that you've made of Paul Gallico's The Snow Goose, and some of the music on this disc you composed yourself. This is your debut, isn't
it? Oh, shucks, you shouldn't have said that, John.
If you could only take one disc out of the lot, which would it be?
Yesterday.
Yesterday.
With John Lennon singing.
And one luxury to take to the island, will you?
A Barclay card.
A Barclay card?
Yeah.
With a view to what?
Well, I mean, while I've got a Barclay card there, I know I'm saving money.
It's a nice philosophy. Right, and one book. The Bible and Shakespeare are already on the island. You mustn't take a big encyclopedia, but any one book you like.
I think I'll take the Rent book.
Is it up to date?
No. I'd take Future Shock by Alvin Toffler.
Yes, Future Shock by Alvin Toffler. And what's it about?
It's about 300 pages, I think. It's just predicting what the course of the world might be like, what a hellhole it might be if we carry on eating the earth alive as we are.
Yes.
It says you've got to conserve the energy of the earth, and what eats the energy is people. Less people, more energy left.
And as a painter, would you like to choose one picture to take with you?
Starry Night Over Arles by Vincent van Gogh.
Where is it, do you know?
Oh, I haven't got it.
No,
I think it's in the Jeu de Paume Museum.
In Paris.
In Paris.
Yes.
But if it isn't, there's a lot of worried people in that museum, baby.
Right. Well, thank you, Spike Milligan, for letting us hear your Desert Island disc.
Well, I did enjoy it, Roy. It's marvellous.
Well, come back again. come and see us again.
Oh, yes, you invite me again in another 18 years' time, like you did this time.
Right.
Bye-bye, Roy. And keep taking those tablets, won't you?